This is Andrew Stotz of A.Stotz Investment Research to talk to you about the top 9 valuation mistakes and how to avoid them. This is mistake number 9, not properly fading return on invested capital. So let's review the top 9 valuation mistakes that I've seen in my career as an analyst, as a head of research, and also in the valuation masterclass and my years of teaching equity valuation. Number 1 is overly optimistic revenue forecast. Number 2 is underestimating expenses causing unrealistic profit. Number 3 is growing fixed assets slower than revenue. Number 4 is confusing growth capex with maintenance capex. Number 5 is forecasting drastic changes in the cash conversion cycle. Number 6, underestimating working capital investment. Number 7, valuing a stock using the calculated beta. Number 8, choosing an unreasonable cost of equity. And number 9, not properly fading return on invested capital, which is what we're going to talk about right now. So most analysts forecast that high return companies will maintain that high level and low return companies will maintain that low level. When I talk about return, we could be talking about return on assets. We could be talking about return on invested capital. We could be talking about return on equity. In this study, I'm using return on invested capital, ROIC. Now, it's almost impossible for a firm to maintain a high level of profitability forever or to remain have losses forever. The management's going to change. The shareholding structure's going to change. Something's going to change. Therefore, fading the ROIC down or up in the case of a low profitability firm reflects the idea that firms cannot sustain excess returns to infinity. So let's look at a study that I'm going to present here. We analyzed 13,000 companies from a universe of 26,000. 13,000 because those are the ones that had the data and were available at the time. And we looked at 10 different sectors to understand how ROIC for a company changes over time. The decay analysis that we did was performed by sorting firms into deciles and tracking the average ROIC for these 10 portfolios. So let me try to explain what we did. Here is a table that shows you an example. This is going to be a hypothetical I'm going to walk you through to understand the structure of how we laid out this report. The first thing you're going to see is that the first year that we're looking at is 1995. The second thing you're going to see is that the number of stocks in 1995 was 13,000 stocks that we looked at. So we broke them into deciles, meaning 10% of them are in, we're broken them into 10 different groups, each of them having 10% of the total stock. So 1,300 stocks in decile 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Now, what really matters to us is the highest decile and the lowest decile. So let's just look at decile number 1. If we then take this group of companies that we grouped in 1995 and just hold them as a group and look at that group's performance over time, what happens to the return on equity or return on invested capital? It goes from 50 to 45 to 35 to 28 all the way down to 16. And let's go down to the other end of the spectrum, the negative, worst companies at number 10. They're starting at 1995 at 20 negative. And then we look forward and say, what happened after 1995? We can see it went to 16, 13, and then all the way to a positive 10. So we're seeing a convergence that's happening there. Again, this is a hypothetical, but this is exactly how we laid that out. Now, of course, we don't need to look at all the different deciles. Let's just look at the first decile, the fifth decile, which is the average, and the 10th decile. And here I'm going to show you the hypothetical still. Here's a chart of that hypothetical where ROIC in theory would fade down and high ROIC, low ROIC would in theory fade up. That's the concept of what we did, but that was just 1 year. So that was the year for the first decile. We can see 1995. 50, 45, 38. But then we go to 1996 and we do the exact same study. And then 1997, the exact same study, and on like that, as far as we can go to still have 10 years of forward data, right? And so from that, we get a table that looks like this. And that's our beginning point. The next thing that we do is then we slide each one of these over and we bring them so that we just have a table. And now, it gets a little bit strange because when we move the second line over, we're moving 1996 number of 50 over to the left to 1995. Well, that's not really true. Therefore, we're going to change that to be year zero, year one. So it happens that year zero for the first group is 1995. Year zero for the second is 1996. This allows us to take an average, and we just do a simple average in this case, an average of year zero. The starting point is 39% of ROIC for high return companies, and that fades down on average to 16. So that's what we did. Pretty cool, huh? We did the same thing for the 10th decile to get an average from that. Now, the findings are essential for valuation, as one option of dealing with the fade and terminal period is to fade the profitability. We need to fade that profitability if this chart shows a fading. So what did we actually find? Here is the actual results, and that is that profitability is mean reverting. We can see that the highest group, the stars we call them, decile one, has a ROIC of 29%, and that fades down to 11. And we can see that the lowest have an ROIC of negative 15%, and that fades up to 2. But what we can see from this is that stars remain above the average, and dogs remain below the average. So you could say, once a star, always a star. But the star falls within 3 years, so be careful when you're forecasting. Make sure that you are fading up or down. But you don't need to necessarily fade to the mean. Let's look at that for a second. Very profitable firms decrease in profitability, and low profitability firms increase in profitability. However, none of them reverts completely back to the mean, right? Now, it's an important distinction to make here. Right now, what we're talking about is the average return on invested capital for, let's say, that industry. This is an overall study, but we can look at a company's average return on invested capital for the industry. But what we would need to do for forecasting is we would need to look ahead 10 years and get that correct forecast for 10 years to know, what are we fading to? What is the ROIC at that 10th year? Well, nobody knows that. So as a result, rather than fading to ROIC, I use a substitute, which is fading to the weighted average cost of capital. So in the value model, we allow a fade of return on invested capital to a 20% premium to the WACC for very profitable firms, and to a 20% discount to the WACC for quite unprofitable firms. Average firms need no fading. Fading to industry average ROIC is nearly an impossible task because we don't have that data, and it would be impossible to get it. So we replace it with the company's WACC. So what have you learned? Fading ROIC to WACC reflects the idea that firms cannot sustain excess returns to infinity. Also, very profitable firms decrease in profitability, and low profitability firms increase in profitability. Finally, fade highly profitable firms to 20% premium to WACC, unprofitable firms to 20% discount, and no fading is required for average ROIC. Those are my rules of thumb. So there you have it, the 9 valuation mistakes that I have seen. Great to share this journey with you. If you've got questions, suggestions, comments of your experience, let me know. Otherwise, I'll see you in the Valuation Masterclass. Take care.